I, Abhishek Mujawadiya, student manager of Sri Balaji Society, is honored and privileged to welcome our guest, Mr. Kundan Das, Director, APJC and Russia, CIS Business Development. Sir is a graduate from Symbiosis Institute of Telecom Management. He started his career with PwC, followed by a stint at Starin Network, Cisco Systems, Citrix, and other OEMs and technology providers, with more than 10 years of extensive experience with startups. Now, I would like to invite Kundan Das, sir, to the podium and address the gathering.
We all are here for a good career, good money. Anything apart from that? That's it, right? So fundamentally, when you foresee what exactly going to happen, which companies are going to be bigger, but maybe they're smaller at this point in time, and if you invest in that, then you have a faster track of growth, and possibly by choice a chance that I could do. So the startup that I was in, called Starin Networks, we sold it to Cisco at 2.9 billion cash, US dollar. Then another is Byte Mobile that we got sold to Citrix at 485 million US dollar. Then we are in the new startup. So all of us who are in Starent, possibly 80% of us left to start the new one with the new investor. Probably that's the shortcut to make money. Okay. But again, in today's context, when we look at business, business is all about intelligence and innovation. There is no business which is secured right now. Brand like BlackBerry, Nokia, they disappeared with no time after having, you know, such big establishments. So what I'm going to cover in my presentation is what was the past, what is the present, where we are right now, how it is looking, then what exactly the innovation experience is all about, then few of the case studies I'm going to talk about. How many of you are from HR? You'll find it really bad, the message. How many from finance? Again, bad, the message. But the good thing is that when you understand what are the threats possibly going to, possibly coming up, then probably you can better align yourself, okay? So, this was New York Fifth Avenue in 1900. Can you make out where there is a car? It is all horse carts, right? So there is a car which is here. Then there is an innovation happened and the car came in picture. Then in 1913, there were no horse. Or there is one horse and all cars. And where exactly we are going forward or in future is all to do with driverless vehicles. They are highly intelligent, highly censored, and this is exactly the future is migrating, okay? And I'm not saying it is something which is going to happen up after 10, 15, 20 years. It is something which has started happening, okay? So now just think about where exactly you will invest yourself, because you are here for the next 2 years, you're going to invest yourself, right? So you are in, you're going to invest so that you can get maximum returns. Now, talking about what exactly the present. Now, this will look really bad. If you actually track recession, okay, it comes after every peak in every 10 years. And possibly, in the next 2 years, if you look at, recession is expected to happen. Okay? Now, the extreme left side of the graph, if you look at, that's called the technology index. Okay? Like, what are the technology stock prices and where they were picked? So, previously in 2007 to 2008, they were in the peak. Okay? And today in 2017, they're at the peak. Okay? So, with all analysis, it is not showing that kind of signs, but you know, recession always comes without any signs. Okay? Then, if you look at possibly in case of India, if you look at last month's report, Center for Monitoring Indian Economy, they've estimated there are 1.5 million job losses because of the two shocks we have gone through. One is demonetization, second one is GST. Okay? But there are some corrections which government is taking, and we are hopeful that things are going to be in track. Now, where we are right now. So if you look at, out of all the emerging countries, so emerging countries are possibly having a higher growth rate of GDP. So India is leading that particular, okay? Now, if you look at the job scenarios, so 60% of companies are expected to go for recruitment, 40% are not going for recruitment. Okay, usually it is more than 80% they should go for recruitment. So when the recruitment actually ceases, it's when your asset utilization goes down. And that is what is happening particularly in manufacturing sector, in services sector at this point in time. And forget IT, can't talk about it. Okay. So with all this going up, like looking like, so salary increments and all, there are 88% chances or 88% salary increment is expected across the board, but mostly around 6 to 7%. Now 6 to 7% salary increase, when your GDP is more than 7%, it is a negative salary increase. Yes or no? Right? But the good part is that because you have a inflation which has gone down, that's why it is perceived to be positive. Okay? Then if you look at sector-wise, which are the sectors are expected to have higher salary increase? That is consumer internet companies, life science, professional services, chemicals, entertainment media, and automotive vehicle manufacturing. Now, coming back to telecom. Now, what is it that we are going forward to? The end of typing and texting. We are moving to an era of video and voice. Now, I'll go to the next one. This is for HR. Do you know this company called Workday? So the objective of this particular company, which is a startup again, but now it has matured, that it wants to replace the HR department of all companies. Last month, they signed a contract with Flectronics. It has 50,000 employees and now don't have a single HR person. So it's a bad news or good news? No, it's not bad, it's good. You have to look at the opportunity. You can't stop it. How exactly they are doing HR, okay? So what they are trying to do is that they are going for machine learning, they are going for individual analysis, everything or their smartphone analysis, everything or wherever the data is coming from the employee that is getting into artificial intelligence, analytics, with lot of analysis, they're coming up with a 360 view of individuals, okay? So it's almost like the software and service is working as a HR personnel for you. Okay. Now the question comes is that where exactly the job for HR? Now, as a functional consultant, probably you are the best person to look at this kind of data, put your intelligence, okay? But if you actually look at the kind of skill set you probably need at this point in time, it is altogether different what used to be learned in colleges in the last decades. Because if you are going to learn what is there, okay, then absolutely there is no relevance to where exactly the companies are going forward. So it is important being a student, not that what is taught to you, what you should be taught, you should know that. So it is very, very critical at this point in time. Or else, you know, you are going to be completely washed out. And don't think any job at this point in time is the secure job. Nothing is secure. Any questions? I know I give bad message, but I think I'm supposed to give that. Any questions from HR? Thank you. So you understood everything. You understood what exactly you are going to be taught, okay? So, to my dear sirs, so this is how exactly, you know, things are changing, okay? So if you look at workday, whatever is taught in the class, it's all good, okay? Because the basics you should know. But try to use all the tutorials, webinars, whatever is available on the internet domain. That is going to give you the right direction, okay? So you will have your base, then you have to go for the directions with a very focused approach. I'll go to the next one, innovation experience. I hope it will be interesting. Now, if you look at in the last 8 decades, okay, any product that you can think of is the most innovative product? Okay. Let me start from here. The first one is Toyota Corolla. It has got now 47th version. Okay. And this is a product which has no legacy knowledge, and they completely made it from the scratch. The second one is Zippo lighter. How many of you use it? You know Zippo lighter? So that's a great innovation. There was nothing like a Zippo lighter before it came. Then there is a Sony Walkman. This is a history, but you might have seen Sony Walkman. Okay, that's another innovative, or you know, one of the icons. Then Rubik is the highest selling, you know, puzzle toy ever sold in the market. Then it is Barbie doll. Okay, and the most amazing one is iPhone. Within 10 years, it could sell 1.2 billion units. So fundamentally, what you're finding is that the innovation has no legacy. You should not have a knowledge about a product to innovate. Because when you innovate a product, you create altogether a different market. And there where the growth happens. Before iPhone, there was no phone which was like iPhone. Okay? So I'll show you one video again, like how iPhone is developed. Do you know this thing, like iPhone and Samsung and Apple had a long battle? Who won finally? Why? Why? Sorry? patents. No, the fight was for patents. So what happened is that when Apple came up with its phone, it has not involved a single person in the R&D who has a phone development experience. When it was Samsung, they got people from Nokia, they got people from Ericsson, Samsung, multiple areas. But Apple developed the phone with absolutely no background of phones. And the target given is that you should develop a product which no one has. Because when you have a legacy, you always link, you know, with that experience, I'll develop it. So in the court, what happened is that Apple could give all the biodata of its engineers. And, you know, they could find out that no one has any experience of Samsung. So there is no copyrights. So everything that they did, it is completely from scratch. Okay? So don't ever think that, you know, if you have background A, background B, background C, then you got into something here, that background is going to help you or not help you. Okay? Because in future, even though you have a background, what is happening for in the future, it has no linkage. Now, I'll go to the case study, and I'll again take the example of Apple. This was Apple in 2006. Apple, Microsoft, Walmart. Look at how they have grown in 10 years. Okay? So, the second one is, if you look at how iPhone has started contributing to the revenue of Apple as an organization. In 2006, okay, there was no iPhone. 2007 it came. And it came with exclusivity with AT&T. No one else was allowed to sell Apple in the market. So that point in time, Apple's revenue share was not existing within the overall revenue base of Apple as an organization. But if you look at 2012, that to 2016, it is almost crossing more than half or more than 50%. Now, what has happened in the meantime is that the App Store, okay, that is a critical component for Apple. And it has crossed more than 10 billion in revenues. So, look at that point in time, there is nothing called an App Store before 2007. And Apple come up with that particular, you know, concept that there is App Store. So people can go and develop their apps and put it to Apple. Or you can download it and put it to the App Store. Now, what impact it further translated to operators. So what operators in 2006, they were, the basic challenge they were facing is that data was not growing good. Okay, now it is like, you know, flowing, but that time data was not growing that fast. So when they could realize that this is a potential product, okay, this can drive out data, they started giving or partnering with Apple. Now when they partnered with Apple, what happened, data grown much faster, and that drove the operator to start investing more in capital expenditure and networks. So what is the difference it further lead to is that Apple started growing in its revenue and operators started investing more in the capex, and that lead to lot of debts in their book. Because when you develop a phone, it's developed. You're not investing further. And Apple is the only company which doesn't invest much big amount in any kind of marketing campaign. Now then comes the impact to camera industry, like Nikon, you know, Canon, those kind of products. Okay, so what happened is here, if you look at the sale of camera after the inclusion of Instagram to the App Store, look at how it changes. So initially the camera companies, they were feeling that no, you know, the phones are never going to compete with us. But eventually it started competing. And there is no stop to it. Okay? So camera companies, they have to reinvent themselves or they have to get out of market. So fundamentally what you're finding is that all your effort goes in innovation and that secures your future. And if you don't do innovation, okay, then your future is always going to be in threat. So my input, you know, it's not complex, it's not simple, I don't know how I'm going to put it across, but please don't do things in a manner when you are not satisfied. And it is not necessary that you should always take a complex route to achieve your objective. You can take shortcuts, okay? Possibly like no one would like to take, but if it can bring you success and if it can help you out in developing something which is really amazing, it's fine. Okay, so what the team there did, they invested in multiple things. Okay, the keyboard, if you look at Apple, is primarily, you know, the major innovation goes is a keyboard. Before that, it was BlackBerry and it used to have the QWERTY keyboard. So the keyboard innovation in that, there were more than 100 people, they were doing parallel innovations. Because you don't know on which track you're going to hit it. Okay? And you have to evaluate everyone. And it's not that they're doing anything wrong. Okay? Each one has its own mindset. You have to think different to others. When it's a startup, there is an idea, you go with the idea, you stand in front of the VCs, then you share your ideas, you share your marketing plan, business plan, what kind of funnels, you know, all those details, okay? But probably down the line, that is not going to be the approach, okay? You have to fill up certain inputs. The system is going to find out whether the idea is going to be successful or not. And that is the system intelligence which is going to give reports to the investor, what kind of risk he's going to have if he's investing on you, what kind of returns he's going to have if he's investing on you. That means the tool that you're using is completely intelligent, takes multiple inputs, forecasts what exactly the future is going to be. So that is how, you know, the markets are moving, or that is how the skill sets are moving. So analyst or an investor as a portfolio, okay, is now again shifting completely to machine learning and artificial intelligence. So that is another domain. Similarly, if you go to a designer clothing shop, so you select certain stuff, the designer says that this looks good, but the camera is going to take your picture, and with number of options that you have selected, the application is going to find out based on your skin color, your face, your appearance, your height, you know, all those factors, which is the right dress. And that probably not the suggestion of your fashion assistant. So the fashion assistant job is again going to be in threat because there is a system which has gone intelligent than the fashion assistant. Because the system takes multiple inputs, more than probably the fashion assistant has taken. The fashion assistant is more relying on his experience. So the last one is connecting the dots. So probably this is the conclusion slide. So when you have multiple data, okay? They're like scattered. Everywhere there is data, they're scattered. But when the data has certain content, it has information. So you may get multiple information coming to you. But when you start connecting them, okay, with your knowledge, with your individual knowledge, you call it as knowledge, right? Then what you do is that you find out which are the critical informations. That is the insight, or there where your business dependency is maximum. It is not every data is important to you, and every data you need to consume to come up with some kind of output. Then the critical ones, when you connect, that gives you possibly 80% of visibility that how exactly you are going to make out your own business or own career or your own plans. Okay? So that is called wisdom. Wisdom and failure don't go together. You can't say someone is highly intelligent, but he has not seen success. Right? So with that, I'll just conclude my session. I don't know how much it is valuable.
Thank you, sir. Now the floor is open for questions.
So my question is related to the work wisdom, work day, which is going to replace the HR department. So the first thing would be implementing it. It would be, that's what my views are. It would be easier for a bigger firm or larger firm to replace it, cause cost, implementing it, and expertise required in maintaining those. And also in case of failures, what would be the effect on the company in case if they decide that not to hire any more HRs? And the other questions would be the emotional parts of the employees, which would be better understood only by a human HR rather than a machine. Because from machine, it would all be a retrospective effect. That is, once the problem is done, they'll have a solution to it, and it's only after then it would be stored in a machine. So going with that, would it be, can we say that HR can be replaced?
Yeah, it's a magic question. So look, what you are assuming is that emotional part of a person, okay, it can't be controlled by machines, correct? But the fact remains is that, assume that you are my boss, okay? I'm doing my work, okay, but still you are not treating me well. That particular feedback, even the machine gets. So you are always under a scanner that if you are wrong, it is not that my report is only going to you. It is your report is also coming to me. Okay? And the machine is going to look at, you know, if a person is working, he's doing his job, then why this person is not behaving rightly? Because the behavior and the emotional part or emotional portion of, you know, the organization, that is also part of the learning. Okay? So that's one part of it. Second part is that, so far it goes with reliability and all. At this point in time, everything is reliable. Okay? But you have to have right kind of infrastructure for that. The third thing is that, how exactly this is going to be implemented. So previously you might have seen that SAP, PeopleSoft, what they do is that, that's more like a software you implement in your organization, right? Okay, so that streamlines the process. But today, the kind of work that Workday does, it is not what SAP or what PeopleSoft are doing. It is software as a service which is hosted on a data center. Okay, so it doesn't. So typically, what happens when you implement SAP? Okay, your HR team is responsible for implementing that one. In today's context, it is not HR. Because the HR can be biased as well. But what you are doing on your office phone, how you are talking to colleagues, that is not something which is going to be biased. So everyone gives feedback about you. Everyone takes feedback from you. Now when you consolidate that as a information and further put more and more analytics to it, okay, you will find results which are going to be completely different than SAP or PeopleSoft. And possibly that is going to keep the overall organization in safe. And the emotional part is definitely going to come out of it as well. And that is what is happening. Like, so typically what happens is that if you start learning this kind of product, so typically what they do is that they do a pilot. They do a deployment for maybe 3 or 6 months. Okay? And then they find what kind of accuracy they're getting. Okay? What kind of feedback? So they go back to the employee and take their feedback. So if the employee is satisfied, if he gets more visibility than the traditional or the organic way of getting it from HR, okay, you'll find, you know, he's more comfortable with that one. Honestly speaking, in an organization, HR means you always look at, oh, HR, okay? So that part is not here. Because you get visibility of your boss, the boss get visibility of you get visibility of your juniors, your CEO get visibility of yours, as well as your boss, juniors, and everyone. And if anything which is not going as per your company guidelines, that is going to pop up as an alarm. Okay? And then the action is going to be taken. It's clear?
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Sagar Babu from BIM HRD. My question is almost similar to what my friend said. Sir, like we say, automation is happening, and we are probably the HR is more concerned about automation because people, like most of the people say that HR is going to vanish. But I believe is even finance, sales, even these portfolios are getting vanished. So why HR is always targeted for automation and it's being reluctant?
No, it's not. Do you know Salesforce.com? So what
yes,
is
sir.
It? It is sales which goes on cloud.
Yes, sir.
Okay? But you need people who are actually going to sell to your end customer. Salesforce can't do it. It can accurately tell you like who is the right customer, who is the wrong customer, and it can, you know, make that particular decision. It can help you with that particular decision. Okay?
Yes, sir.
But end of the day, you're going to do it.
Yes.
So I personally feel HR as a job, okay, is going to be more implementation of this kind of portfolio,
yes,
as well as sales of this kind of solution to companies. Because a company can only buy this, okay, it cannot be bought from a person who comes from XYZ background. A person who has an HR background, he can sell it better than, you know, any other background.
On behalf of Sri Balaji Society, I express my profound gratitude to our guest, Mr. Kundan Das Sir, for sparing his valuable time to guide us for a successful career. We are greatly encouraged by your gracious presence, sir, and immensely benefited by your inspiring address. I would also like to thank our beloved Bala Sir for his guidance and providing us such a stimulating and learning environment. I hope there would be many more meetings with you, sir, on and off the campus. Thanks for coming. Have a nice day, sir.